Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'd like to welcome you all to our discussion. And on the panel today, we have Tawanda, we have Austin, and we have myself, Kevin. We'll be discussing the first lesson of the new quarter entitled What Went Wrong? Or rather, I think it was What Happened. Yes, what God's it was What Happened. That was the first day, but the lesson is The Promise, God's Everlasting Covenant. Okay, with that, I'm going to ask Austin to open in prayer for us. Let's close our eyes together.
Thank you, dear Jesus, for bringing us here this morning. Thank you that we can learn more about you. Thank you that you take a special interest in our lives and that you came to earth and that you made a way of escape for the problem that we caused. Please be with us now as we delve into a very simple but also very important lesson. Please help us to understand your plan of salvation and to understand why you did what you did. Please forgive us for our many failings. And please help someone to be blessed by our discussion tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, with that, I'm going to introduce the lesson. So this week's lesson was pretty interesting. I quite enjoyed the refreshing take on a rather simple topic, but still quite profound because the implications of our understanding of this topic would determine how we live our lives, one, and also where we end up eternally. So it's quite important that we understand this concept first so that as we move on to bigger and deeper concepts, we've got the right idea and the right, I guess, mindset for God to speak to us and also to guide us. But yeah, we start off with the question, what happened? And our memory text comes from Genesis 1, verse 26 and 27. And it says, Then God said, Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. So the biblical account of creation is filled with hope and happiness. And after every day, we hear God saying, It is good. And at the end of one of the days, we hear God saying, It is very good. Now, surely this pronouncement didn't include things like earthquakes, typhoons, famine, diseases, the coronavirus, that kind of thing. So, what happened? Why is it that we have all of these things? We have to deal with all of these things these days. The sixth day of creation ended with the phrase, very good, as I mentioned earlier. And that's because on this day, God created something special. He created human beings. And not just that, he created them in his own image. Or rather in their own image. So, of course, they were perfect in every way because they were created in his image. So it didn't include things like murders and sin. But this week we'll see how perfection in God's creation led to what we now know, and also how it speaks to God's character, or how his actions speak to his character, and how hard he's working for us on our behalf. We're going to look at a few questions, one of which is, what does the Bible teach about origins? What kind of relationship does God want with humanity? And what was the purpose of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? And what hope was given to Adam and Eve immediately after they fell? It's interesting that the hope was given immediately after they fell. But I hope that the rest of the week's discussion is going to be one that's filled with a lot of things that I missed, maybe, and that you as a viewer didn't see looking at this creation story, as you may have done a few times before, or even if you haven't, I hope it'll give you a fresh take on it. So, yeah, with that, I'm going to ask that we move on to Sunday.
Thanks, Kevin. On Sunday, we are addressing one of the questions that Kevin asked. What does the Bible say or teach about our origins? That's the question we're going to try and answer on Sunday. What does the Bible say about the origins, how this world came into being? And how has that got to do with the covenant? Because I know this quarter we are studying about the covenant. And it's interesting that we are starting off in Genesis. You know, many times people would start referring to the covenant in Noah's days, in Genesis chapter 9, after the rainbow shows up. But we're starting off in Genesis, so I found that take very interesting. But let me go on to what Sunday is briefly discussing. It starts off with one of the verses that I learned as a young child, Genesis 1, verse 1. We can probably say it off the top of our heads. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. So what I find interesting and what is also highlighted in the lesson or when I was reading through and going through is that there is a beginning, but in that beginning, there is a God. We're not told of his origins, but we are told of our origins. So, and one of the questions that comes to mind is, or one of the questions that all of us face, or that all of us have is, where did we come from? And the Bible starts off by telling us there is a God and he created. When I was reading in the week, I came across what the author was trying to express by this aspect of creation. He says the word that is used in the original language in which the text is written for create is bara. And the Hebrews, when they're using that text, they are looking at God's ability of creating something from nothing. So creation or our beginning start from nothing, but from a God who creates from nothing. And so for me, it got me thinking, if the Bible is highlighting that we start from nothing, except that there's a God who begins to create, then there should be some form of evidence of God in the creation that he has put across. Now, the Bible does not really tell us where his origins are. You won't find it in Scripture. It's nowhere written. All you have to do is to take it by faith. I like what Paul writes in Hebrews chapter 11. The text is Hebrews chapter 11, verses 3. It says, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. Things that were not there came into existence by the mere word of God. And he says it takes faith to understand that. The other view in the world is evolution or the Big Bang theory. The people who propose the Big Bang theory also make their proposal based on some assumptions. Some of it is actually faith, because I overheard this discussion once. The probability that something can explode and carbon gets formed is 1 times 10 to the power billion. There's so many zeros on the power aspect. So when you look at the mathematical side, it's not even a chance that it could happen, but it takes faith. And here the Bible then now explains the origin, saying, no, hey guys, there is a God who created. He spoke and things came into existence. And because there is a God who created, hence everything that plays out in creation or in this world has to have its focus or has to have its origins in what God has intended. And these are some of the things that we will go through. So one of the questions that is clearly answered is that in the beginning, God created. And when you go through the Bible, in the lesson study, when you're reading from Psalm 100, verses 3, it says, know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us and not ourselves. We are His people and His sheep. So we have been, this is so many years late after creation. Someone then highlights in the Psalms that it is God who created. We did not come into existence by thinking, by imagining, or our own imagination, or by chance, or by fluke. It is God. But what he highlights many years later is that God created us as his people, suggesting that God created us. He wanted to have a relationship, and he identifies the relationship. We are his. We belong to him. This is why he created us. Another text, I'm just picking on texts here so that we may get an idea of who created and what were the purposes of this creation. Because we are told in the beginning, it is God who created. I like Colossians chapter 1, and I'm reading here from verses 16 in the New King James Version. It says, "For by him all things were created, that are in heaven, and that are in earth, both visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, all things were created through him and for him." Verse 17 then puts the icing. "He is before all things, and in him all things consist." It was for him. That's why things were created. And one of the reasons why worship continues to take place even after this earth, because we've got an origin, and God gives us a story as we'll be studying that. No, although things are messed up, God still wants to restore us. And one of the things we'll be doing when we get to heaven, we'll be worshiping. And in that worship, we'll be worshiping him as the one who created the heavens and the earth. Maybe as I conclude on Sunday, before I take any contributions and questions from the rest of the panel, is there's another question that is asked. We know why we're here. We know our origins. The next question will be, why are we here? And you discover when you study in the Word of God, God has a plan. We're not here by chance. First of all, we looked at the aspect of the relationship that would exist, but we're here to give him glory. That's why we're here. That's why he created us. It is to give him the praise, the honor, the glory, for we were made in his image. The other thing, or one of the reasons why we are here, and Jesus spells it out to his disciples, is that you and I should love one another. Right, because as Kevin highlighted earlier on, one of the things that we'll see as we're studying about this covenant relationship, about the covenant, is God's character. It will become clearer and clearer to us. And as we'll be studying, and I don't want to preempt, but as we'll be studying, you'll see that one of the reasons why God created us is to express love. And that is the expectation that he has. That's one of the reasons why we are here on earth. I do not know if the rest of the guys have got any questions or contributions on Sunday, but from my side, I think it all begins with God. He created, and this is why we're here. Kevin?
Thanks, Tawanda. Austin, I see you were ready to share something with us there. I'll give you a chance first, man.
Thank you, Kevin. That's very gracious. So when I was looking at Sunday's lesson, I thought of it from the Adventist perspective, because we all Adventists here, this is probably going to be seen by a lot of Adventists. So what relevance is it revisiting our origins? Because we all already know that God created us. We all know the story of creation from when we were 12, maybe. So what's the relevance for us today? And I thought about that, and I figured it out for me, at least. This is no absolutely right or wrong answer when it comes to this. But as created beings, we need to think about something apart from ourselves, because pride is the original sin. It's what caused Lucifer to, on his downward spiral of destruction, pride. So when we think that we are created by God, God formed us, he decided one day to make us, it sort of humbles you. Because you can never be greater than your maker. Do you understand what I'm saying? It puts your life into perspective. It makes you understand why you need to serve God, why you need to listen to Him. Because if someone like God, He made us, therefore He knows how we function, He knows how our minds work, He knows what we need to do in order to be rid of sin. So then, as a Christian, you can understand that as a creator, He is also our sustainer, and this is why we obey Him, this is why we worship Him. If one day I decided to worship Kevin, it doesn't make sense because Kevin didn't make me, Kevin doesn't know me. You understand what I'm saying? Me and Kevin are on equal terms here on this earth. But when we think of God as a creator, that He made us on purpose and for a purpose, that's what Uncle Tawanda was saying, then we understand our position and our what we ought to do in His service. It just brings things into perspective. Kev?
Yeah, I like what you said there, Osti. The perspective of just looking at things one way doesn't really get us anywhere. We have to widen our gaze and look at it from a very macro point and move in for us to see what it is we're really getting at. And that's why I like this lesson. It's something that we're rehashing maybe for the 15th time as we go through this kind of thing. But we're still learning new things and realizing that there's a certain amount of faith required for both beliefs is a commonality that we can use when we are trying to make friends, because ultimately that's how we get anything done. Any discussion can only start when you have a commonality. So I'm enjoying this so far, and I think you next, right, Aust?
Yes, Kev, I am next. So, Monday's portion of the lesson, the title is In the Image of the Maker. Now, when we think about creation, it's really a one-liner. The whole of Monday's lesson speaks about one line in the Bible because it only says that we were created in His image. Further than that, we don't really think about it generally. So, this was a very interesting thing. So Genesis 1 verse 27 reads as follows. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him, male and female, He created them. So Monday's lesson speaks to the importance of understanding what it means to be created in the image of God. We need to be mindful that we were created on purpose and for a purpose. When we consider the time and effort God took to create us, it speaks to our value as His children. So it's become very prevalent in society today, the question of value. What gives you value in life? Some think that success, like worldly success, money, a steady job, something that gives value to you, but that's actually not the case. The very fact that you are human, that you are an important part of God's plan, that gives you value. That doesn't mean you need to live a useless life and reject work and do that just because it doesn't add to your value. No. Valuable people seek to add value. I'll leave it at that. As we consider what a privilege it is to be created in the very image of God, we should be mindful of our purpose here on earth, which is to prepare ourselves and others for the heavenly cause. It's very simple when we think about creation and the fall. We were created perfect. I don't know if you read additional reading after every lesson. There's additional Ellen White quotes if you're online. And then it says there that when God created us in His image, we were perfect in every way. We were as God intended us to be. From the fall, progressively, we've been getting worse and further away from the intended image to now. We can't even see God because in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were communing daily with God and heavenly beings. They saw God face to face. They were close with Him. They knew Him like you and I know each other. They were very connected to the life-giving source. Now, how many thousands of years later, we are so far apart from God that we need to make it our life's purpose to remain by His side. It's not something that you just decide to do one day and not the next day. You need to understand that with sin separating you from God, it's imperative that you maintain daily communion with Him, that you renew your connection with Him daily so that you can stay close to the life-giving source. And once you experience God for yourself, and many of us in the church have a theoretical understanding of what it means to have a close connection with God, but once you actually experience it, that is when it becomes meaningful to you. And when something becomes that meaningful to you, you can't help but pass it on to others, which is inevitably what we are here to do. So, in conclusion of what it means to be made in God's image, we need not lose sight of God's objective for us, which is to restore His perfect image in us. We can't even comprehend the way God intended us to be. That's how far we've fallen. But God is going to do what only He can do, which is restore His image in us sinful vessels. And I think we need to always bear this in mind in our Christian walks, because it's been a struggle for me personally when I have to think about giving up sin, because many of us have a false sense of sin in our minds. We think that sin, we know that sin is bad, but we neglect to admit that it is pleasurable. Certain sin to us is very pleasurable, but at what cost? Because God has a perfect ideal for us, and as His children, we should strive to achieve that. And no sacrifice that we can make can even equal the sacrifice that God has made for us. And I'd like to encourage the panel to comment on what it means to be made in God's image. What of what relevance is that in today's life, Kev?
Okay, so something I saw and that I liked particularly about Monday's lesson, Austin, there was a section where it spoke about what it means to, I think it did speak a little bit to what it means, but it spoke of it from a very spiritual perspective. But something that stood out for me was the fact that the Bible emphasizes the spiritual and mental aspects of our mind, and how these aspects can develop and improve. And it's the uniqueness of the human mind that makes possible a nourishing relationship with God, something the rest of God's earthly creation is unable to do. I found it quite interesting how that is a part of God's character that's a part of God's image that we still have. And it's something that's not necessarily shrouded in mystery, because we do understand that. We know that we have better reasoning ability, or rather we have reasoning ability, whereas animals don't necessarily. Animals act on instinct. But how often is it that we ourselves are not, we find ourselves acting on instinct instead of reasoning? I bring this up every time I'm on the panel, but in tight situations, you find yourself reacting instead of doing something on purpose. So something I took away from Monday was that, you know, I am made in the image of God, and that means I'm supposed to show that image to others. And the image that I'm showing is the image that somebody may just carry on believing. So for me, it's important that no matter what I do, that image stays at the forefront. But yeah, it's really what you as a person believe about God, and how that's influenced by your study and your communion with God, that will then show in daily life. So that's, I guess, something that grows as we spend time with God. We see more of His image in ourselves.
Yeah, just something to add about the image of God. What is also interesting when you look at this whole creation account is that after Adam had been created, day number one, he he was given the opportunity to name animals. So basically he could look at an animal, figure it out, and then probably describe it and give it a name. For you to name something, you normally have to describe it. So that means the creation of humanity was not progressive. It wasn't in stages. What came from the hand of God was something that was to an extent full, something that could reason, something that could think. It didn't have to discover things. I said, yes, there were lessons that humanity had to learn from the experience it had in the garden and meeting with Christ. But at the point it came from God's hand, it had certain functions and capabilities, which is different from the other view which we get in the world. The world would suggest that we're Neanderthals, we had to, you know, discover things, yeah, and which is not the case. When God created us in his image, he created us as beings who are able to think, who are able to make choices and decisions, which we'll see plays a very important factor as we're going to be reading through this lesson. He gave us the ability to choose and the ability to think, to assess, to look at a situation, read from it, and then after reading from it, give a solution. When you think about it, I got daughters, now they're growing up, they're young, and you teach them this you do not do, and you explain to them why you do not do it, right? But you always know that after having instructed them, if you leave them in the same situation, same environment, the same thing that you told them not to do, they're bound to do it. So it's there's a risk of sorts. But you love them so much that you allow them to go through the experience of wanting to learn for themselves. Okay, this is what Dad said. Okay, if I don't do this, I'll be safe. But if I do this, these are the repercussions. They make their own decisions and choices. So for me, when I was going through Monday, I thought that was that's awesome. When man came into this world, he wasn't a dummy. He could think, he could reason. The Lord then gave him instructions, now make choices and decisions, yeah.
I think it's also important to note that he was fully aware of his faculties. He knew what he was able to do. It's not like he had to first figure out, hey, I can actually use my hand for this. It's just an interesting thought from what you were saying there, Tawanda.
I think it's very interesting to consider briefly the opposing view of evolution. Evolution, people believe it because they don't want to believe in God or they refuse to believe in God. But it's very interesting to consider that when you think about evolution, let's for a moment believe that it's true, then your life, the average lifespan, let's be generous and say 80 years, which means you have 80 years to fulfill whatever purpose you give yourself. And thereafter, there is nothing for you, nothing further. Your life basically is within those 80 years. Give it another 50 years after you die and you are meaningless unless you've made some massive contribution to the world that will be left behind. But when you think about creation and you think about a creator that's invested in us personally, that's personally given us not only a purpose, but the ability to fulfill that purpose, that offers us not only a reward down the line, but promises to be with us now, to enable us now, to help us to do everything that we need to do. And it's very interesting to consider people's rationale because I'm currently studying law, and there's a principle that's known as natural law. It's personal morality, what you believe is right. Everyone believes that killing is wrong. And when I say everyone, I mean the vast majority, that killing is wrong. Not once someone close to them killed, but evolution proposes survival of the fittest. But everyone inherently and morally knows what's right and wrong, and it goes contrary to evolution. Survival of the fittest has nothing to do with preserving life, loving others. It's about carrying on living for yourself, not for others. But everyone inherently wants to live for others. They don't want bad things to happen in this world. And it's very important to just consider these various things. I think we can move on to Tuesday.
Okay, I'm taking Tuesday. As Kevin highlighted, some of the questions that we're answering is, what kind of relationship did God want with humanity? So you saw that Monday we were looking at him creating us in his own image. So half the time, the friends around us are people who enjoy similar things to us. There's common grounds between us. This is why they are our friends, right? So you see here, God creates someone in his image, right? And someone who shares something with him, meaning that he wanted to have a relationship with humanity. This is why there's that common ground. Now, on Tuesday, we are looking at the relationship he wanted us to have. So, and we will be looking at the text that is found in Genesis chapter 1, verses 28 and 29. I'll read the text, then I'll try and unpack it, and I'll then ask the panel to give me their viewpoints. The text basically reads as follows. It says, then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, see, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed to you, it shall be food. So here, God then gives, does something for humanity. He's created them in his own image. Then he blesses them. So the first thing that I learned when I was going through Tuesday was, what an awesome God we serve. He blesses humanity. That's where it starts. He starts by giving a blessing. In a world that we're living in, right, many of us find it hard to make ends meet, and you wonder, ish, how am I going to make it to next week and stuff like that. We often forget, no, that there's a God who pronounces a blessing. What are the blessings we get from God? The gift of life. You're awake. Each day is an opportunity. That's a blessing. So God pronounces a blessing to humanity. And this has always been his desire, to bless humanity. As you might also remember when the Israelites, when they were journeying from Egypt, going to the promised land, Canaan, God instructed Moses that, hey, please give the Levites, a charge to pronounce over my people always. And that charge was to bless the people of God, to remind them that there's a God who loves them and who blesses them as they go along, even in their journey. Back to verse 28, one of the things that God does, he says to humanity, be fruitful and multiply. Remember, we're looking at God and humankind together. So God pronounces a blessing. He then gives humanity the charge or a command, be fruitful, go out and multiply. So for me, when I'm reading this, it becomes like the first commandment they got. Be fruitful. Go out and multiply. Then the question was, why should they multiply? I like a comment that you find in when you're reading from the lesson study. It's taken from I'll read it here quickly because I printed it out. It's taken from Review and Herald, paragraph 3, 1903, or you also find it in Bible Commentary, Volume 1, right? This is a powerful quote. It says, God created men for his own glory, right? That's why God created men. He created them for his own glory. And in his own glory, the purpose was for them to repopulate heaven. There had been a crisis. A third of the angels had relinquished their posts, and God had created men to repopulate heaven. If man was to, I'm just paraphrasing the quote, if man was to overcome the test he was given, he was going to make up the numbers that the Satan and the rest of the angels that followed him had left. So God had a purpose, and he told men, go out, multiply, and be fruitful. Now, in that command, it also speaks to some of the things that Kevin was mentioning, that in life, you know, we go to school, we study, we want to provide, we have to be fruitful, we have to labor, we have to work. When you read in chapter 2, when Adam is created, he's given a garden that he has to tend, he has to have his attention drawn towards. We have to be fruitful, we have to work. It gives meaning, it gives purpose. Half the time when people go through depression, it is they fail, they're going through stuff that they fail to see their purpose in life. And God, right there in the beginning, he's saying, hey, you've got a purpose, you have to be fruitful. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it to the honor and glory of God. It should yield something, it should yield a reward. Then, as you are reading verses 28, we are told that man was then given dominion. That's a gift. He is just brought into a place that is created. He's given a garden. He's naming animals. He says, hey, now you are supposed to rule this place. So God's relationship with you, with humanity was, hey, I am the being who created. I've created you in my image. You are now going to stand in on my behalf and watch over the things that are underneath you, that I'm going to give charge, that I'm going to give you charge over. So you see the aspect of stewardship coming out. That's the relationship God intended to have with humanity. A relationship where he blesses them, a relationship where he commands them to do things, to be fruitful, to multiply, a relationship where man acts on his behalf. In other words, since we are created in the image of God, God's intention was that the world around us, the world that he had given us dominion over, was supposed to see God in humanity's actions, and because we were created in the image of God. So that is why. So I found that very interesting and uplifting, and it got me thinking that, hey, the Lord loves us and he gives us these opportunities so that the world can testify. When you read later on in the book of Romans chapter 1, it says one of the things that the world yearns for is to see the sons and daughters of God. And this is the relationship that God gave us from the beginning. He made us in his image so that we could reflect his character and qualities. As I conclude on Tuesday, before I take comments, is what I would also like to say is the responsibility that it comes with. God is blessed. He has imparted fruitfulness. He's given us dominion. How do we respond to that? As you realize that, remember, our quarterly, this quarter is about a covenant, and covenant is basically describing a relationship. We can pick up from some of these aspects that, hey, you know, God is doing everything. He's giving everything. He wants us to respond in a particular way. It might be with what you have, those who are around you. Are they seeing that you were made in the image of God? Do you share what you have? Because many a times we think, it's me. I get my payslip, it's payday. I spend it on me and my family. But are the people around you also benefiting from the blessings that God has given you? So, yeah, those are some of the things that I picked up on Tuesday. Are there any comments, guys?
Yes, just a short one, Uncle. So, when you think of the concept of the fruits of the Spirit, most specifically reflecting Christ, the whole concept, sometimes we misunderstand, it's a basic concept, the fruits of the Spirit. Many of us try to be kind, we try to be gentle, we try to be patient, but we always fail. When it, like Kevin said earlier, we react, and then our reactions are not manifesting the fruit of the Spirit, because many of us are focusing on the absolute wrong thing. We're not supposed to be focusing on making ourselves better, because that's not our purpose. Our purpose is to get to know Christ. Let him come into your heart. And this goes back to what we were discussing. It just hit me. It's very important. What we were discussing close to the end of last quarter about the effects of sin. So it's simple. It goes like this. Sin separates you from Christ. Sin stops your prayers from reaching Christ. It stops you from hearing Christ. Therefore, there's a separation. And when you are separated from Christ, bad things ensue. You do not manifest the fruits of the Spirit. You do not love each other, the 1 Corinthians 13 way. So it's very simple, and I'm experiencing this in my life right now. Once you start systematically removing sin from your life with God's help, then you start hearing Christ. Then you start experiencing him for yourself. Then you understand why he expects you to give up sin. It's not just because he feels like you don't need to stop sinning, because Christ just one day woke up and decided you should stop sinning. Your only lifeline from here to heaven is through Christ. And you cannot experience Christ the way you're supposed to while you're still sinning. And just as a side note, we as Christians, we know exactly what sin is. Even if it is cherished, we know it's there. Even if we justify it saying it's not sin, because there are certain gray areas deep in yourself, in your heart, you know what is sinful in your life. You know what you need to stop. Whether you want to or not is a whole different story. But the step needs to be taken to stop sinning, get closer to Christ, and then these things manifest themselves. Then we reflect Christ. We don't try to become better, then go to Christ, and then we become perfect. No, it does not work like that. Because without Christ, we can do nothing. And I just thought that's an important fact to share. Kev?
Yeah, I like what you said there. Even, I mean, it doesn't work like you don't go to the bath clean. You go to the bath dirty and you come back clean. And that's because when we come to Christ, we come to him as we are, and he then removes the sin. So we start wanting to come closer, as we want to come closer to Christ. He removes the sin from our lives. He shows us, hey, that thing, you know what it is, like you're saying now. You know exactly what it is. I want more time with you, more communion. Get rid of that. And he will, Philippians 2, that says, it is Christ that wills and works in us for our salvation. So it's not that we're alone. It's not like we don't have it's not like we don't have any help. Christ is there for us. He wants us to be better. So it's quite, I appreciate that point you made, Osti. And Genesis 1 verse 28 and 29, I think, Tawanda, you brought out some important points there about God giving them a purpose, because once, as Austin said, beings of value add value. So if we are not adding value, it means that we don't know our own value. And so we need to spend more time with Christ and contemplate why it is we have value, or why it is Christ values us. Because in so doing, we can then go forward and share that value that he has instilled in us with others, because that's exactly what he created us for. Is to love, first to love him and to love our fellow beings.
Thank you, Kev. So moving on to Wednesday. Now, Wednesday is a very interesting day, and it speaks to the evolution of sin, as well as the concept of free will. And when I say the evolution of sin, I mean the progression of sin. It has very little to do with the theory of evolution, just for clarity there. And the heading of Wednesday is at the tree. So Genesis 2, verse 16 and 17 reads as follows. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Now, it's important to consider that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, Adam and Eve are not supposed to eat of it. that was the only point of contact for sin in that garden. Otherwise, everything was perfect. It's not like it is today, where the devil had free roam, where he could have tempted them to do a zillion other things. There was just one thing, one tree, and it's appropriately named the knowledge of good and evil. There was nothing in that tree that was, say, poisonous. No, it's the concept, the very presence of sin. Sin is the disobedience of God's law, and it's staggering to think of how just disobedience to that law, not doing something heinous, just this mere disobedience to the law of God can cause such catastrophic consequences. So, now it is important to consider that Adam and Eve interacted with God himself regularly, that they saw the work of God's hand in all its perfection, and all they had to do was obey one restriction. What God was asking of them, no matter whether you believe in Christianity, whether you believe God is fair or what, you can never say that what he asked of them is unfair. Of every tree in the garden, you may freely eat, but of this one, you may not eat. It's a very simple test of faith. And the devil doesn't get everybody using the same bait. What the sins that appeal to Kevin are not necessarily the same sins that appeal to me. The devil tailor makes temptations for certain people. And it's very interesting to consider that God told them exactly what would happen. He told them that in the day that you eat of this, you shall surely die. And how Satan gets us is that he mixes truth and error. And he's so manipulative that he knows exactly the weak points of everyone, which is why it emphasizes yet again the importance of having a connection to Christ. Because the devil is in the tree. He's saying that God is withholding something. There's something about this tree that God does not want you to experience. Hence, he's telling you not to eat of it. But he also tells them a truth, that in the day that you eat of this, your eyes will be opened and you will know both good and evil. While their eyes were open, they saw all the other evil that was before hidden to them. You understand? Because they saw no sin in the Garden of Eden. They only knew that they shouldn't eat this tree. But as soon as they took the fruit, just like that, they knew evil. And just knowing about sin caused this downward spiral in the human race, to where now people do unspeakable things to each other. They are so perverse from a tree. So when you look at the origin of sin, you understand now why we cannot focus on ourselves, how our very nature has changed. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve naturally wanted to do exactly what God said. They had to be convinced otherwise. Now it's switched. We want to do exactly what God does not want us to do. And he is saying, come close to me, I will teach you, I will show you what I want you to do, and then you do it, and then others will see your good works and glorify God in heaven. And it's very important to spend thought and consider what sin is. And it's been such a turning point in my life to consider sin, because sin, and I'm going to say it again, I've said it now in this lesson study, sin is enjoyable. It's not something that has to be very ugly. It has very ugly consequences. But in our daily lives, I'm talking practically now, we enjoy sin naturally. It's our natural inclination to enjoy sin. So to say sin is bad, no one can enjoy sin, is an incorrect statement. It's enjoyable. But at what cost? That's the crux of the matter. At what cost are you enjoying this pleasure of life? And it's not really a pleasure, because I don't know about everyone. In fact, people apart from God, especially Christians who know the theory, they can enjoy sin, but there will always be that part of them that is missing something. It can't be explained, but only God can fill that gap. And it's only once we get rid of sin that everything falls into place. Many of us, and it's very scary to think about it, have not experienced Christ for ourselves. We don't know what it means. Therefore, we can carry on sinning because we don't know what it actually means. have a connection with Him. The joy it brings, the fulfillment it brings. When you see your behavior changing, when you feel less negative emotions, then you understand what it means to have peace of mind. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That's in Matthew somewhere. Once you experience that, then you understand how sin has been systematically separating you from God. And I'm very passionate about this topic because I'm experiencing it now. Once you start separating yourself and actually experiencing what it means to be close to God, then you understand that what you're giving up, it ceases to be a sacrifice. In the beginning, it is difficult. It's difficult to let go of sin, but it's worth it. It's that simple. And I think we all need to just take away from that sin is destructive. No one likes the effects of sin, but we all seem to have a hard time giving it up. But there is hope, and God is more than willing to help us. And I'd like to open the floor to the panel to comment on this very interesting lesson.
So, Austin, I really like how you brought out the point that God gave them a test, but also He gave them hope at the same time. He said, don't eat of this tree, but here are 15, I'm going to use a number, but He didn't really give them a number. For all we know, there could have been an orchard of other trees that they could have eaten of. And in the middle of the orchard was this one tree they were not supposed to eat of. So it took work to get to that tree. That's my imagination of it anyway. But God gave them so much possibility, so much choice, and He told them which choice was bad, why it was bad, and He encouraged them to choose the right thing, but they still chose the wrong thing. Like you said, sin is pleasurable, and our lot on this earth is to choose the unpleasurable thing, with the promise that we will have the endless ages of eternity to spend in a pleasurable way, praising God, glorifying God, discovering or rediscovering our faculties that we've lost because of sin. Not just 80 years of a seemingly insignificant life, but an everlasting life that we cannot even begin to imagine right now. It's not something we should take lightly. And like you're saying, once we start separating ourselves from it, we can actually see God the way we're supposed to. We mend the relationship that we broke. And I think that's why Enoch was no more, because there was just nothing left for him here. God said, my friend, I can't have you down there anymore. Join me here and let's contemplate how we're going to help these people. I'm really enjoying the discussion we're having, guys. Tawanda, is there something you want to share with us?
Yeah, I just want to add, thanks, Kevin, for the lesson there. That connection to Christ. Remember, Christ is the life. And the choice that is being presented is choose life or choose death. Now, as you've already highlighted, when we separate ourselves from Christ, we're separating ourselves from life. So the end result is death. And this is what is happening. The tree of life offered to them a choice. Right? And humanity had to choose. Adam had to make the choice. Eve had to make the choice. What are they choosing? And it's still the same choice today. Still the same choice. What would you prefer? Do you want to have life? And as Kevin has already highlighted, you need to follow Christ, connect with Him, have a meaningful relationship with Him. When you choose that, you will get life. This is His promise in John chapter 10. I've come so that they might have life and have it more abundantly. So the aspect of the tree for me when I was going through this lesson was It was there for a choice. And the choice is based on what would you want to have? Would you want to have life, a meaningful life? It might not be meaningful in what the world expects, but it's meaningful because it comes with a promise. Now, the other aspect that I also wanted to highlight was that, remember, we're looking at a relationship, which is a covenant. And in relationships, you normally have, for lack of a good word, is rules, regulations, right? With your spouse, if you're married, there are rules there. There are certain things as a husband you not just do. You'd have to consult. You have to do certain things. For you guys who are looking for spouses and looking for, you give each other rules. Every relationship is defined by some form of regulation. And I think for that in the relationship that God had with humanity, the rules, his law, define the parameters of the relationship. And in that choosing, it's a life or death choice. Every time you choose to disobey God, is you're severing yourself from life. As highlighted earlier on by Kevin, is sin somehow, it's a spiral. You do one thing, you remember the story of David. He looked at a woman lustfully, slept with a woman, lied to the general, killed the husband. That's how sin, it keeps pushing you away from God. But you can make the choice. I can choose today to have life. And this is the beauty of getting to know in Christ. You can choose today to have life, accepting him as your Lord and Savior, accepting to foster a relationship with him, prayer, Bible study, going out and witnessing from time to time. Then you'll have life. And that was the choice that was presented to Adam and Eve. And they chose the other way. It's unfortunate. And we are living through the consequences today. Thanks.
Thank you, Uncle Tawanda and Kevin, for those comments. I think this is shaping up to be a very intriguing discussion from a seemingly simple lesson. It actually surprised me a bit. But we need to consider these things. It's not something we should take lightly, because many of us in the church, we know the theory, but the theory alone won't get you saved. It don't get you anywhere. And the only reason why we haven't experienced Christ for ourselves is because there are barriers preventing us from doing so, barriers that we ourselves put up and that we are scared to take down, because we have a funny picture in our minds of what God's purpose was for our lives. And personally, I was very scared. I was like, if I surrender my life to God, if I do everything he says, including the Sabbath, when I'm working and I can't work on the Sabbath, that's going to affect my livelihood. But the Bible also says that David said that he never saw the righteous forsaken or begging for bread. So we shouldn't be scared either of what God wants for us. His intentions are pure. He's not human beings that let us down. And I don't know where it's found, but I know the verse. It says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good," because we on the panel, us three, can talk for 5 hours about the goodness of God. And if you haven't experienced it yourself, it makes no difference. So I think we can move on to Thursday, moving closer to the conclusion of our discussion.
Thank you. So quite often when we talk about creation, at least for me earlier in my life, I would I'd have this thought, why did Eve do that? Why? She had so many choices. But in Thursday's section, we see that Satan, as Austin said, he doesn't tempt everyone with the same bait. Satan does specimen fishing. He uses specific bait that attracts you. And he knew exactly how to lure Eve. And so he took a very specific approach. In the same way, he takes a very specific approach with us today. So, as deplorable as Eve's transgression was, and as fraught as it was with potential woe for the human family, her choice did not necessarily involve the race in the penalty for her transgression. It was the deliberate choice of Adam in the full understanding of an express command of God, rather than hers, this is Eve's choice, that made sin and death inevitable, the inevitable lot of mankind. Eve was deceived. Adam wasn't. Man, creation, God created us equal. God gave us both the faculties and the wisdom to choose. But Adam, I think Adam chose much more poorly in this instance. Adam had a chance here to do something that we often have the chance to do nowadays, is he saw somebody in sin, and he had the choice either now to come and draw her closer to God again, or go with her. In the same way, Satan puts people in our path as well that are sinning. And we also have the choice now whether we are going to draw these people closer to God, or whether we're going to draw away from God with these people. And as a result, two are lost. Two are lost where one or both could have been saved. So we see that it was Adam's breaking of a relationship that resulted in the situation we find ourselves in. As a result of this blatant transgression and disregard of God's command, the relationship is now broken. It changed from fellowship to us fleeing from God and fearing his presence. Alienation and separation replaced fellowship and communion. Sin appeared, and all its ugly results followed. Now, if we look at this and we contrast it with the idea of evolution, we see that creation was perfect, and it tended towards sin. Okay? Now, this was because of a choice. But after the fall, creation was as close to perfection as it could ever have been. It tended toward destruction. The idea of evolution suggests that we would move closer to perfection. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I seem to notice more and more ailments and problems in life. So, yes, our lifespans have gotten a little bit longer over the last 200 years. Yeah, things have gotten a bit easier for us, but I wouldn't say that things have gotten better for us as a race. In fact, I'd venture to say that this is an educated venture, I guess, but we are the worst we've ever been. So God's words of prophetic hope that he speaks to these two at the end of as soon as they had fallen, are so fitting now, because it shows that there is a climactic victory that we can take comfort in. God told them that, listen, that serpent that tempted you, that supposedly started all of this, we'll crush his head. Yes, he bit your heel now, but we will crush his head in the ultimate victory, and we'll be reunited. God gave them a reason to believe that all was not lost. And in their utter hopelessness, they were to gain hope from this, utter helplessness, they were to gain hope from this promise, because this was a promise that was given to them by someone they hadn't trusted before, and now they knew the results of not trusting him. So it's like you've had a taste of the bad that somebody warned you about before, and now they're saying, look, you've done the wrong thing, but I'm giving you a second chance. How often today do we see a second chance go wrong? How often do we see a third chance go wrong? And here, humanity is given not just a second chance, but hope. Hope. It's not just a second chance. It's a chance for us to be renewed, a chance to go back as if the previous one had not even existed. So, however vaguely stated at the time, that promise lifted the bear from the gloom into what was or what can only be described as a real hope for the heavenly promise. Genesis 3 verse 9 poses a question that, or in Genesis 3 verse 9, God poses a question and he says, "Where are you?" Before I invite comment, I'm just going to introduce some of Friday's section. And Charles Spurgeon said that in those three words is a gospel sermon. Just those three divine words penetrated the dense parts of the thicket and reached the tingling ears of the fugitives. "Where art thou? Thy God is not willing to lose thee. He has come forth to seek thee, just as by and by he means to come forth in the person of his Son, not only to seek, but to save that which is now lost." The question I have is, because the kind and caring God is one who seeks humanity, how can we respond to his expression of love even now? And how does God expect us to respond? That's one question. The next question I want to ask is, how essential are loving relationships to human happiness? And why is a flourishing connection to God necessary for such relationships to even exist? I mean, if you didn't have a very strong connection to God, how likely is it that your marriage or your relationship with others around you would last? I'll go first and I'll say that from the statistics we see, divorce is it used to be a 45% probability. It's not anymore. It's now quite a bit more. And people have a saying that friends are temporary and you only need one or two good friends. It all just speaks to the fact that our relationships with each other are suffering, and there's one element that fixes a lot of it, and that is a flourishing connection to God, as stated so beautifully in the lesson. When we understand where we are and where God wants us to be, I think our relationships with each other and our relationships firstly, our relationship with God can only get better. And I think that's the way God expects us to respond, is to share what we gain in communion with him, with others. And to answer the question of how we can respond to this expression of love by the Father and Jesus Christ, there's only one way. We should really just accept it. It's the to do anything else it's unspeakable. I may use a strong word here, but it's unspeakable insanity.
I think off briefly, Uncle, and then you can go. It's very important to consider when God was walking through the garden just after Adam and Eve had sinned, he asked the question, "Where are you?" And this is an important question now. Where are we? And it needs to be personalized. We should stop pointing fingers, because it's individuals that need to be changed. Like, I mean, us, not as in I'm talking to Kevin to change and I'm talking to Austin to change. Where am I? And then a follow-up question, where do I want to be? I mean, beyond getting a job and living my life and then eventually dying, where do I want to be? What is my purpose in life beyond just serving the capitalist system we find ourselves in? And then when you consider that, and then you think about God's offer of salvation, and you always think about God's offer of salvation as good. His offer of service on our behalf is also very good. He offers us a job. We have a job to do, and that's a very good thing. And when we consider what we want and where we want to be, it fits into It should fit into our plans to, you know, want to be go to heaven, want to serve God, and then everything falls in place. We don't try to love each other. We try to be close to God, and then we ask Him to help us. He helps us to be close to God, and then we end up loving each other. It's a very a bizarre thing that we need to wrap our heads around. It's a learning curve. We can see the rough edges in ourselves. We know we have short tempers sometimes. We know nuances. We know what we need to fix, but we don't know how to fix it. That's the important thing. We don't know how to fix it, so let God fix it. It's a very simple concept that I'm learning to accept.
Okay, Ish. You know, when we started out this lesson, looking at where we came from, is already highlighted by Kevin and you, Austin, is you realize something, that God desires a relationship with us. He put it there, right? Although man strayed away, it is Him who came looking for man. And He asked Him, "Where are you?" Now remember how Eve fell into sin. She had to think, consider, you know, enticed by the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the desires of the heart. She fell. But God asked him the question, "Where are you? Consider where you are, how you got there." Now remember, Adam and Eve had put leaves around themselves to cover themselves. And God, when you continue reading Genesis chapter 3, God does something for them. He clothes them with lambskin. Not only does He do that, He then creates what I believe was very essential and critical, enmity between the sinful desire and humanity. For without that, we would have continued. So what I'm seeing in this story of creation, because we're going to be studying about covenants, and my little understanding of covenants is a relationship between us and God dictates the terms, is God is showing us that right in the beginning, even when men had failed, because we'll see how the covenants are going to be reinstated over and over again when Israel fails or when humanity fails, God will come in, and God always brings the solution. He always gives the solution. He does not leave the relationship to just die. He always gives the solution. So that gives me hope. It gives me courage even today to ponder about some of the challenges I'm facing. That, Lord, if You could do it for people who rebelled against You in such a way, like what we've learned, they had several choices, but they chose that one. You hear? You can still, you know, I know, and that's your plan. Christ came. You whilst we were yet sinners, Christ came and He died for our sins. There is hope for me, and that's the hope I'm getting as we are concluding this lesson, that it is God who does it, who meets the requirements of the relationship. When you try, as you've highlighted, as already highlighted, when you try on your own to meet the requirements, you'll always fail. But if you allow God to come and meet the requirements, and He does it so well, everything that was needed to restore Adam and Eve or to put them back on track, it is God who provided. And it is God who still provides even for the relationship that we are also desiring to have with Him. All we need to do is to give Him a chance. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, gentlemen, for the comments. I'm going to close with a statement. God created us in His own image so that a loving fellowship could exist between Him and us. Although the entrance of sin shattered that union, God seeks to restore this relationship through the plan of redemption. Life for us as dependent creatures takes on true meaning and clarity only when we enter into union with our Creator. And I want to add a word there again. Every day. It starts with that question, Austin, paraphrased for us. Where am I? And where do I want to be? With that, I'm going to ask Tawanda to close for us. And I hope that as we study next week's lesson, we will continue to ponder those questions and remember that we have a covenant with God.
Okay, let's bow our heads as we pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the opportunity you gave us to look into your word yet again and to see the beauty you have in store for us and to realize a lot of things today. We thank you, it is your desire to have a relationship with us, and you have made it possible for that relationship to be there. We have a Savior and a Redeemer in Christ, a big brother, one whom we can cry out to in our times and seasons of need, and as it's spelled out in your word, he will hear us whilst we are still praying, and he will meet us at those points of need. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for wanting to restore that relationship. What we now desire, dear Heavenly Father, is hearts that are willing to enter into that commitment, into that covenant, into that relationship with you again. We cannot do it in our own strength. And we thank you that you've even given us another provision through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. May it be our day-to-day meditation to have our hearts filled up again with his presence and to have you lead us, for us to understand the will and the purposes you have for us. As we will continue studying the rest of this quarter, Lord, it is our desire that we draw closer to you. But most importantly, in drawing closer to you, our relationship with you may be strengthened, so that when you come, which is very soon, as we see in the world around us, Lord, we may be found written in the book of life, not because of what we have done, but because of what you have been doing in us and through us until that glorious day. Bless everyone who is listening. Bless those who are involved in preparing for this discussion. Keep us from falling, for this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
The man you're seeing in the middle of the flood is Marcelo, a 43-year-old man trying to make his way back home during a severe torrential downpour in the state of Sao Paulo, Brazil. After crossing the street, he gets trapped with his bike in swirling waters. As horrified onlookers saw his situation, they desperately screamed at him to let the bike go, but he clung to it. A group of people even risked their lives by forming a human chain to try to save Marcelo, but they could not hold him back. He tries to stand, but the strong current knocks him over and drags him away. Firefighters found his body washed up later the same day. Marcelo lost far more than the bicycle he was trying to keep. What is the bicycle in your life? What is it that the Lord is asking you to let go, but you are still clinging to? A relationship? A job? An addiction? What is preventing you from surrendering your ways to Jesus? What keeps you from being fully devoted and loyal to Him? Ellen G. White says that Jesus does not require of man any real sacrifice, for whatever we are asked to surrender is only that which we are better off without. Ellen G. White, Counsels on Stewardship, page 300. As you return your tithe and give your promise, ask Jesus to help you embrace what really matters and let go of anything that could jeopardize your salvation. May we put our desires last and God first.
Standing at the crossroads of faith and deepest fear, so afraid of failing if you move on from here. The road ahead is steep, but you're not giving up, 'cause God's about to take you to a brand new place of trust. Take a step of faith. It's time to move. Lay aside your fears and watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're about to climb. Higher heights await you, beyond what you have dreamed. And they're yours for the taking, if you dare to believe. So leave your doubts behind and let God make you brave. 'Cause He has come before you and He's already made a way. Take a step of faith. It's time to move. Lay aside your fears and watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're about to climb. You may feel you can't go on, it just seems too hard. Just put your hands in His, He will take you to the faith. It's time to move. Lay aside your fears and watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're about to climb. There's victory ahead.
I'm happy to greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior. This is chapter 12 in the Total Member Involvement series, and it's entitled The Disciple and the Final Harvest. Now, what impresses me about this series is that it comes straight from headquarters, you know. When I was working, we had what we called a GOM, a General Office Memorandum, you know. And often, the boss would just ask in a meeting, did you read the GOM? And this was important. So what I'm trying to say to you is that the message is important. Total member involvement comes straight from the general conference. This is head office. And not my words, it's not the conference's words. These are suggestions and recommendations straight from the general conference. And total member involvement is a call to serve. If you are part of God's last day church, please understand that you are called to serve. Now, disciples are gained through Christ's method of friendship and testimony. That means that we are not fake. We shouldn't be fake. We should love people the way Christ loved people. And we should share with people our testimony, what we've experienced through the love of Jesus. All right? Now, total member involvement is about becoming active disciples of Jesus. We are here to testify about God's love in to everybody in these last days. Here are some practical ways to become involved. Now, this is the last slide, but in case you become bored with me repeating things from the general conference, let me say from the beginning, that here are some practical ways for you and I to become involved. Number three is the most important. So number one, invite other members of the church to get involved. Number two, organize a small group and visit and pray for the community. Now remember, you can't do this if you don't love people. Number three, most important. That's why it's number three. That's why it's in rest. Ask for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Once in a while? No. Daily, we ask that the Holy Spirit will live out the life of Christ in us. Now, what we need to understand, if our efforts to lead someone to Jesus using Christ's method, that is the method of friendship, and it does not seem to be yielding results, remember, the final harvest is soon approaching. God's word will never return void. What should we understand about the final hours? The first concept, it is prophesied. What does Bible prophecy teach? One, Revelation 14 has three angelic messages. Two, these angels represent the prophetic function of God's last day church. It started in 1844. Three, their purpose was to preach God's last appeal to the world. God's last message, God's last appeal is a message for the whole world. Not for the Seventh-day Adventist Church only, for the whole world. It is necessary to preach it to every tribe, language, and people. It is such a wonderful thing to be involved in such a worldwide organization, and we should see it as a privilege. It has as its center the eternal gospel. In the context of the pre-Advent judgment and the worship of the true and only Creator, we need to know what is in Revelation 14. The message is urgent, which is shown by the first angel flying to deliver it, the remnant going over all the world to proclaim it. The proclamation of the message is an amazing word of seed sowing, not harvesting. At this time, let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Our Father, help us to understand that we are to sow the seeds even if we don't see any results, and that the harvesting is God's work. Please, Father, forgive us our sins of the past and help us to remember this now and in the future, for we ask it in Jesus' name. The second concept, the harvest. What does Bible prophecy teach? Revelation 14:14-16. Now we as good Seventh-day Adventists, we know the verses before this because we are taught that in Pathfinders and in Master Glide, and we remember those. But sometimes we forget 14-16. I looked, and there before me was a white cloud, and seated on the cloud was one like a son of man, with a crown of gold on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Then another angel came out of the temple and called in a loud voice to him who was sitting on the cloud, "Take your sickle and reap, because the time to reap has come, for the harvest of the earth is ripe." So he who was seated on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was harvested. Revelation 14:14-16 is a prophecy and a promise. The day is coming when Jesus will harvest what his church has sowed. Ellen White in Christ Object Lessons, page 65, says, "The good seed may for a time lie unnoticed in a cold, selfish, worldly heart, giving no evidence that it has taken root. But afterward, as the Spirit of God breathes on the soul, the hidden seed springs up at last, bears fruit to the glory of God." Isn't that wonderful? We may not see results. I don't know if you have planted something ever, not from seedlings, from a seed. You see nothing, and you water and you wonder if you aren't wasting water and time. But the day comes when you, if you've done your work, when you see the little seedling, and very soon you will see the grown plant. And if you're successful, you will eat the fruit of your labors. In our life work, we know not which shall prosper, this or that. This is not a question for us to settle. We are to do our work and leave the results to God, with God. In the morning sow thy seed, Ecclesiastes 11 verse 6. And in the evening withhold not thine hand. Do your work. Trusting in this promise, the Father, Isaiah 55 verse 11, "The farmer plows and sows. Not less confidently are we in to sow spiritual seed, trusting the assurance, so shall my word be. It shall accomplish that which I please." Who reaps the harvest? Who reaps the harvest? Is it you and I? Conversion is a God thing. We can sow the seed, but the rest is up to him. The third concept, there cannot be a harvest without sowing. Man has his part. Remember Christ's object lessons, page 65? Man has his part. He must prepare and enrich the soil and casting the seed. He must till the fields. But there is a point which he can accomplish nothing. Nothing. No strength or wisdom of man can bring forth from the seed the living plant. He, that is you and I, must still depend upon the one who has connected the sowing and the reaping by wonderful links of omnipotent power. It's time for the final harvest. How do we know that? We can look at the world, it is falling apart. There is a credibility crisis. There is fear everywhere. The planet moans with birth pains. There are increasing natural disasters. It is time, I tell you, for the final harvest. There can be no harvest where there is no sowing or care. And we are the sowers. We are the ones to sow. We are the ones to care. Our work of love is to be done. Our challenge is, this is the mission of every disciple, to seek for Christ, to seek people for Christ, to tell them God loves them, and there is no time to lose, brothers and sisters. What's at the heart of our mission? We are to go with love as our tool and bring them to the kingdom of love. You know, I think of a story that Jesus tells in Matthew 13, I believe, if my memory serves me correctly. He tells another story that while a man who has planted good seed was sleeping, an enemy came and sowed weeds. So when the plants came up, the worker said, "But you sowed good seed." And the farmer said, "An enemy has done that." So the workers wanted to remove the weeds. But the instruction was clear. You are going to destroy the good plants. Let them grow together. Our work is not to look who in our midst is weeds and who are tares and who are good seeds. Our mission, we are to go with love as our tool and bring them to a kingdom of love. And we are reminded as we raise awareness, we must, one, continue working although we don't see prompt results. Two, understand the prophecy of Revelation 14. There is a day coming of reaping. Realize that there will be no harvest if we do not sow and cultivate. You know, it is sad The Bible tells us, can a mother forget a sucking child? And reminds us, she may. But God will not forget. You know, it is sad that sometimes, my mother had a saying that she reminded us about, and that is, Christianity begins at home. You know, it is sad that sometimes we don't even help our children with their lesson at home. We believe the teacher at school must teach the maths, and the teacher at Sabbath school must teach the lesson. It's very sad. We neglect to sow the good seed and to cultivate, to water, to throw the compost. We must realize there will be no harvest if we do not sow and cultivate. Be clear that the work of conversion belongs to the Holy Spirit. It is a God thing. Be patient. Don't, if somebody doesn't listen and persist in sin, we stop loving. Don't do that. Because the harvest is divine work, not human. Remember the Bible says in Matthew 24:46, it will be good for the servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. Doing what? Fulfilling the mission of sowing. This is the last slide. Let me remind you. Total member involvement is about becoming active disciples of Jesus. And these are the practical ways. These are suggestions. There may be others. Remember, number three, the last, the most important, he said last. Remember, one, invite your brothers and sisters in church to get involved. This is a plea from the General Conference. It's not something that Edgar or Rodney thought up. It's a plea from the General Conference that we become involved. Organize a small group. Talk to your friends. Visit and pray for the community. They don't need to know you do that. Walk amongst them. Pray for them. And number three, ask for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. This ends chapter 12 of the total member involvement. Please, brethren and sisters, let's get involved. And I'm sure there are many of us who would like to be involved. And it is our God-given responsibility to be involved in God's work. Remember, if you are part of God's last day church, you are to be involved. This is the plea of the General Conference. This is the plea of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This is my plea. God bless you. Thank you very much. Let's pray together again. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that the promise is sure, that you are coming to make an end of all the pain. You are coming to harvest the good harvest, and you are also coming to make an end of sin and suffering, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name.
So many times I've questioned, certain circumstances and things I could not understand. Oh, and many times in trials, weakness blurs my vision, and then my frustration gets so out of hand.
It's then I am reminded I've never been forsaken, and I've never had to stand one test alone. When I look at all the victories, the Spirit rises up in me, headed through the fire. My weakness is a match to war.
He never promised that the cross would not get heavy,
and that you would not be hard to climb. Oh no,
he never offered victories without fire.
Take you through.